There's no question about it. Someone out there wants you dead. Either it's for something you know or something you did, or it's entirely indiscriminate. There are people out there who only exist to kill. And some of them, either by technique or by chance, will never be caught. And they will leave those who surround your corpse without a clue of where to begin. It's widely recognized that the survival of one government depends heavily on the information it has on other governments. Gareth Williams was a codebreaker for MI6, otherwise known as the Secret Intelligence Service in the United Kingdom. He was an avid cyclist and well known for being a very private individual, which could have been expected from someone in a position such as his. But among the stress you'd expect from thwarting terrorist attacks, Gareth experienced a disdain for the rat race his position required running in. He was tired of jumping through hoops and complained of friction at work. This lack of satisfaction led him to request a transfer to another department. This is to believe to have upset his superiors. So Gareth made preparations for his new job, a new job he would never be able to take. He suddenly stopped showing up for work. Though he was displeased with his work conditions, skipping out on the job wasn't in Gareth's nature. About a week passed before his superiors finally reported him missing. In August of 2010, authorities entered the flat Gareth had been living in and searched for him. But he was nowhere to be found. At first. Authorities discovered a large North Face duffel bag resting in the bathroom tub. The outside was locked with a padlock, which left everyone just dying to know if what was secured inside this bag held a clue to Gareth's whereabouts. It held more than that. When the padlock was removed, Gareth himself was found dead inside, just about a week shy of his transfer date. Immediately, foul play was suspected and an investigation into Gareth's death was launched. But considering it took his superiors so long to report him missing, the cause of death wasn't so simple to determine anymore. Though he had no wounds to his body and there were no signs of him having experienced a struggle in any way, his death was still found highly suspicious. Over 300 attempts were made where a man of Gareth's size tried zipping himself into a similar bag. All were unsuccessful, but it was determined that, in theory, it might be possible to do it. However, not without getting his DNA all over the lock and the bathtub, which there was none. None on the lock, none on the bathtub, none on the zipper. In fact, there was barely any DNA to gather in all of the flat itself. It had seemed that someone had scrubbed the flat almost impeccably clean. While police were initially very adamant about foul play, they suddenly, for an unknown reason, changed their mind and released a statement claiming that Gareth more than likely zipped himself in the bag and died. While they may consider the case closed, many others, understandably, do not. Prostitution. It's one of the oldest professions in the world. However, it's one of the most dangerous as well. But for one prostitute in Stockholm, Sweden, no one could have expected the fate that awaited her. Lily Lindstrom was 32 years old in 1932. She had been married to a man before the two filed for divorce, and she took to a life of prostitution. She lived in a small apartment and often would have her clients meet her there for sex. Aside from the clientele, Lily also had friends come over to visit, in particular other prostitutes that lived in the same building. One such friend, named Minnie, was visiting with Lily on May Day, and the two were preparing to take part in the festivities that evening. Suddenly, Lily's phone rang. Lily answered her phone, and a man spoke on the other line, asking for her by name. Minnie listened in as the man requested Lily's services. She figured it wouldn't hurt to get some work done before the celebration, so she invited him to her place, and Minnie willingly left Lily to herself. Minnie saw Lily again later in the day when Lily came to her door looking for condoms. That was the last time that Minnie would see her friend. When Lily didn't answer her door later in the night, Minnie just assumed she and her client went to enjoy the celebration. It was 3 days before everyone began suspecting something was wrong and police got involved. Police forced their way into Lily's apartment and discovered the horror that awaited them. Lily was lying dead, face down on her bed with her clothes folded neatly on a chair nearby. Her body, however, appeared to be a bit thinner than normal. Near her body was a soup ladle with blood residue inside. Under closer inspection, it was revealed that Lily's body had been drained of all of its blood, and whoever had done it had drank it all using the soup ladle. Authorities swept the entire apartment, but never found any sufficient evidence. The incident was known as the vampire murder case, and the vampire himself seemed to disappear without a trace. Despite their best efforts, police were never able to catch the one that they called the Atlas Vampire. With Karen Silkwood's job, there came a lot of risk. Karen worked at a nuclear fuel plant in 1972, where she was part of the Oil, Chemical, and Atomic Workers Union. She took part in a strike against the company, and once the strike was resolved, was appointed to the union's bargaining committee and was the first woman in the history of the company to hold that position. She was tasked with monitoring health and safety around the plant and came across numerous violations that left the workers at great risk for contamination. Contamination from plutonium. Workers often performed routine self-checks. It was a part of their job to be sure that they weren't contaminated. Unfortunately, Karen discovered that the company, which had relaxed on regulations in order to speed up production, had caused her and others to become contaminated. In early November of 1974, Karen discovered her body contained almost 400 times the legal limit of plutonium contamination. Though the plant had her decontaminated, it wasn't of much use. Health physicists surveyed her apartment and found startling levels of contamination in numerous areas of her home, even on food in her refrigerator. Her levels were so dangerous that even the air she expelled from her lungs showed levels of heavy contamination. Believing that the company was putting her and many others at great risk in exchange for financial gain, Karen contacted a New York Times journalist. Karen assembled a great deal of documentation, including files from the company. She wanted to go public to expose her employers. She hopped into her car to meet with the journalist, but she would never make it to their meeting. Karen's car suddenly went off the road and crashed so severely that it claimed Karen's life. When authorities inspected her vehicle, they found sedatives inside. Her blood level came back as containing twice the recommended dosage for inducing drowsiness, which would have rendered her not only unable to drive, but barely able to even walk to her car. How she managed to get behind the wheel of her car under the influence of such heavy sedatives is unknown, but there were other suspicious factors that arose from the tragedy. There were skid marks from Karen's car, suggesting that she tried to force her car back onto the road, something she wouldn't have been able to do if she were under the influence of the sedatives. Not only this, but Karen's car had damage to the back, even though her accident was a front-end collision. Even deeper investigation showed paint chips in the dents on the back of her vehicle, paint chips that didn't match her car's color. All the signs that another car must have struck her. Perhaps the most unfortunate thing, aside from Karen's death, was the fact that the documentation and all of the evidence was gone from Karen's car, and it was never found. Evil is in no short supply in our world, and sometimes even the most benevolent of people can't keep it from finding you and taking you. But wait, it's not over yet. My good friend Matthew Santoro has provided you with the second half of this collaboration with a video called The 10 Most Bizarre Deaths of All Time. You can watch it now by clicking here or going down into the description below, and there is a link down there for you. His video is sure to leave your jaw on the floor, so don't pass up this opportunity to watch and be sure to subscribe to his channel. That's all for now. Remember, you may not believe it, but anything is possible in a world so seriously strange. I'm Rob Dyke, and I'll see you next Wednesday, so don't forget to subscribe because you won't want to miss what's next.